Over to the floor then, who'd like to kick us off?
Okay, let's go.
Hi Matt, pleasure to meet you. Obviously Southampton born and raised. So
see that from the shirt.
You're, a god. I personally would consider you among one of the greats of the modern Premier League era. Looking at that video, I think we can all agree with it. But would you agree that your place among the greats of the Premier League is some, not jeopardised, but not taken as seriously because you played for a smaller club and not a bigger club like United?
Yeah, I think that's always the case in football. I think a lot of football fans' mentality is that to be a great player, you have to play for one of the great clubs. You know, the kind of thing, you haven't played for a Manchester United or a Barcelona or Real Madrid, and you haven't won any medals, and you can't be a good player. So whenever I kind of get that argument, I kind of get YouTube up, pull that up and go, not bad, was it? So yeah, it does a little bit, but you know what? It really does. I loved my 17 years as a professional footballer. All those things that happened there and all the other goals that I scored and memories that I'll take with me throughout the rest of my life. And hopefully, I've given people like you and obviously people a lot older than you guys here who probably could barely remember my career now, a lot of memories to take with them throughout their lives as well, supporting Southampton Football Club.
Yes. Hi Matt. I don't know how much that you've played for a big club. I mean, obviously you love your club in Southampton, but have you ever wished that you had a chance to play for one of the bigger clubs?
No, I've never had any regrets about staying at Southampton my whole career. You know, it was, I've always been quite a loyal person to my friends and that kind of stuff. So I always felt that Southampton were the team that took a chance on me. I was just a little kid from Guernsey. You know, very few footballers had ever come from Guernsey before. Southampton gave me a chance to make it as a footballer. And I felt like I owed them something throughout my career. And at Southampton, I was able to play the game how I wanted to play it. You know, I was a little bit different than most people. I viewed football as an entertainment industry first and foremost. And people spent a lot of good money to go watch football, and I think they deserve to be coming away from football matches thinking, wow, I'm glad I saw that today. And that was kind of the moments that I lived for, and that's what I tried to give to people when they came and watched my football matches. Yeah.
Do you think more recently, with Southampton as a good example, all these star players, even season after season, the loyalty's pretty much completely gone now?
There's not a great deal of loyalty around now. You'll find now when people talk about players that are loyal, they'll probably point to people like Gary Neville, like Jamie Carragher, people who are at top teams already and were winning trophies and challenging for trophies and earning good money. You probably don't get too many people staying their whole careers at a club perhaps the size of Southampton when they have chances to move on. And I think the amount of money that's available today makes it a lot more difficult for players to be loyal. You know, back in my day, for instance, in the mid-90s when Chelsea came in for me, they bid about £7 million to try and buy me in 1995. At that point, I think I was on about £2,500 a week at Southampton. Had I moved, I could probably have earned maybe, I don't know, £12,000, £14,000, £15,000 a week going to Chelsea. Yes, that's a big difference. But nowadays, you might have a player at Southampton who might be earning £20,000, £25,000, £30,000 a week, who is offered to go to a bigger club. The wages will then go to like £150,000 a week. Now that is a massive difference in terms of the amount of money that you can go and earn elsewhere. I think in this day and age, I think if I'd have been on £20,000 a week at Southampton today and somebody had come in and offered me £200,000 a week to go somewhere else, I might have found it a little bit more difficult to turn that down. So it's a little bit different these days. Yes.
Well, how much have you enjoyed your role with the media on shows like Soccer Saturday, and did you ever consider being a full-time coach instead of doing it on TV?
I never really enjoyed the coaching side of things. It never really was a passion of mine, so I didn't really consider that too seriously, if I'm honest. And the TV side of things kind of appealed to me a lot more. I think the fact that you can kind of do your job without any pressure. You know, you go into management, you're under pressure with results. You know, you're always facing the sack if you have a bad run of five or six games. So I didn't really want that in my life, and I quite enjoy keeping involved with football without having those kind of pressures around. And the job at Soccer Sack is perfect for that. You know, I get to watch football every weekend through the week. It's a great excuse when I'm at home and the wife wants to watch Coronation Street. And I go, sorry, love, but we've got to have the Champions League on, it's my job and I've got to watch football. She can't argue, it's brilliant. Yes, sir.
Were there any other slightly wackier offers when you finish your career? I mean, those are the two standard offers for most at kind of bad time. Were there any others that were slightly weirder?
Just after I retired, I was asked to go on a new television show that they were just about to start, which was filmed down in Australia in a jungle. So I was actually offered to do the first series of One Celebrity Get Me Out of It, which I turned down. I did.
Sorry, can I just interject at this point? Because I didn't see the end of this. We were talking about this last time, and you might really know. But how did you get on in that thing you were on recently with the, what was it called?
Oh, Eternal Glory.
That stuff, that man.
Mm. Yeah, it was a game show type thing. I ended up coming third. There were a bunch of eight former.
Some
very serious competitors. There was a few Olympians in there. Yeah. There was a great challenge where we had to do a hurdle race over about 400 metres, but you had to fix the hurdles yourself. But you're only allowed to compete in the race once your heart rate dropped below a certain amount. So it was quite scientific the way they did it. So my claim to fame now is that over a 400 metre hurdle race, I beat three Olympians. who wasn't quite a decent 200 metre runner, and I beat him over 400 metres. The fact that the rules were in my favour a little bit had nothing to do with it. I leave that bit out when I tell people. It's a great place to play.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
If you didn't pursue football, what would you have pursued as a career?
My entire childhood consisted of sport, basically. I was quite good at a lot of sports, and I think if I hadn't been a footballer, my next challenge would have been trying a bit of cricket. I was quite a decent batsman back in the day, and I kept wicket as well. So that would have been my next choice.
Are there any players that have played for Saints since you retired that you wish you played with when you were playing?
Good question. I think the two on top of that list would be Adam Lallana and Ricky Lambert for me. I think going from League One on the rise up to the Premier League, I thought those two players were pivotal for me and were outstanding in those seasons where we had the two promotions. And Adam was a player that whenever I go down the Saints, I always look forward to watching him, and I was really disappointed when he left. That was a big shame for me. Obviously, Ricky's goals and his free kicks and his penalties. We'd have had some fight to see who was taking the penalty. We might have to take one each, I think.
You did have to shoot out in the Super Cup.
I let him beat me, really. Because he's still quite young, and I thought, I don't want to embarrass him. Yes, sir.
Of today's current Premier League managers, which one would you most like to work under and why?
Question. A lot of the Premier League managers today actually insist on their forward players pressing the ball quite high and defending from the front, so I'd have to cross a few of them off my list. But as a personality, I think Jurgen Klopp is very infectious. He's a kind of manager who kind of really would want to go out there and play for. I think in his early years at Chelsea, Jose Mourinho would have been on top of that list for me, but I think the last couple of years he's just lost his mojo a little bit. He doesn't seem to enjoy his job as much. He's not quite as charismatic, and he moans a lot more than he ever used to. So he's chopped down the list.
In fairness, though, we're a lot more passionate than Chelsea very difficult.
So, well, this is true. I wouldn't say that on camera.
Has
someone like me, you wasn't old enough to remember you playing. Which player currently would share your sugar to?
Unique.
I've always struggled to answer this question. A few years ago, I used to say Dimitar Berbatov. Because, you know, he was quite silky, but, you know, didn't really run around a great deal, but scored some great goals. So he was the last one I think I can remember who I would kind of put myself as that kind of player. I think maybe the position that he plays at Tottenham, I think Dele Alli, yeah, the kind of goals, the areas that he gets in the pitch, that kind of player, I think I was, although he probably tracked back a little bit more than I did. Right at the top.
Do you think young players get too much too soon?
Oh, 100%. Absolutely, yeah. And I think we really struggle in this country because of it, because I think you see a hunger and a desire for these players when they come and they break through into the first team, and everyone gets really excited about them and go, this is the next big thing. And then you get given the big contract and 100 grand a week, and you've got everything you could ever wish for. And it just takes a little bit of an edge, and that's all you need to take off somebody. Them to go from being top draw to being pretty good. When you want to try and win something at an international level, you need a lot of players in your team who are top draw. And I think by the time that our players get to that level, they've kind of got everything they want in life, and a little bit of the edge has been taken off. And I think that's one of the reasons why sometimes we struggle at international level. I think there should be something around that should kind of look after these players a bit better in terms of their finances. Maybe they've earned that contract, but don't give them all straight away. Just give them a percentage of it. Don't let them even see the rest of it. Put it away from somewhere and just give them a little bit of it and just keep them hungry and just kind of try and keep them grounded a little bit, really, because I think the money that they earn sometimes, it makes them think that they're almost invincible in this world, and they can go and do whatever they want outside of football and get away with it because they're earning all this money. And I think it can be quite dangerous to give young kids that much money so soon, and I think the clubs need to take a little bit more responsibility for it. Yep.
Thanks for being here, by the way. Big thing for going from Norway.
No problem.
Well, kind of leading up from that question was asked by my colleague there regarding, do you feel like that academies prefer the Premier League and prepare for it, so what happens if they don't make it? And do you think they have the necessary skills, you know, tools to survive, you know, like if they don't make it as a footballer?
It's a good question. I think they do try to give them some kind of academic background as well. I think what the problem, I think, at the moment with certainly Premier League academies is they want their players to play a certain way. So they want them all to be comfortable with the ball, they want them to be able to just pass around nicely. And I think the one thing they don't teach them, which doesn't help them, is if they don't make it a Premier League club and they have to drop down a couple of divisions to play in League One, League Two, where the football isn't quite so pretty and, you know, it's a bit more of a battle and you've got to be more physically prepared for it, I don't think they're prepared for that football if they don't make it at the top club. So I think the footballers, I think, need to be a little bit more rounded in their approach with the young lads, that if they don't quite make it there, that they prepare them to go and play in a league that's a lot tougher physically and perhaps mentally. And I think at the moment, those boys that come out of those Premier League clubs struggle to go and play in a couple of leagues down for that reason.
Yeah. Do you still have like an influence down at Southampton? How do you think club legends should have an impact on them as they used to play?
I don't have any influence at Southampton. They treat me very well when I go and watch the games. The chairman invites me into the boardroom to go and watch the games. I'm made welcome to go to the training ground and watch training pretty much as and when I like, which is great. And I think that's nice, and that's the way I think most clubs would treat their former players. I think some of the clubs actually do a bit more with their former players in terms of having them in the lounges at the games with all the corporates and mixing with the corporate people. I think that's something maybe that Southampton could do a little bit more of. But I think it's on the right lines. It's certainly a lot better than it was a few years ago.
Right at the top.
A
couple of questions. I mentioned clubs wanting their academies to play certain styles of football.
What do you make of Claude Puyol's style of football comparison to say Ronald Koeman or Pochettino previously?
Yeah, it's not quite as progressive, not quite as attack minded as the previous two managers. And I think a little bit of that was forced on him by the amount of games that we had to play this season because of the Europa League stuff. I think he wanted to play a type of football that wasn't quite so dynamic, that wasn't going to wear the players out. And I think that was the reason why he kind of went with the slightly more defensive formation and a slightly slower build-up. I think as the season goes on now, and we're kind of coming to the back end of it, I'd hope that we would actually say, right, the players have had, we've done a lot of rotation, so the players shouldn't be that tired. Now let's find our best team and let's play for the next 12, 13, 14 games, however many we've got left, and see how far up this Premier League we can get and see if we can win a trophy as well, which is, you know, what football's all about. We've got ourselves into a cup final for the first time since 2003, you exclude the Johnson Paints Trophy. And you know, we've got a real chance to win our second major domestic trophy in our history. So if we can do that and finish the season strong, if we would have finished in the top half of the table and have a trophy in the cabinet, I think a lot of the negativity around the style of play, I think would disappear if we would finish that high up in the table and win a trophy.
I was at Anfield when we beat the Queen Week in the
excellent. So was I.
Has Jamie Carragher spoken to you since?
Not really, no. It got a little bit heated in the studio at times during the game. But to be fair to him, he was quite gracious after the game. And, he was very kind in the words that he said about Southampton, the way that we played and over the two legs that we deserved to go through. And I think that's absolutely right. I mean, we should have. Really, looking at that first leg, you know, that should have been 3 or 4 nil going into that second game, and it shouldn't really have been a game at all. So I thought the best team over those two legs definitely went through, and Jamie agreed to me.
You said earlier about Chelsea coming to you. Do you think not going to Chelsea had an effect on your England career?
Yeah, I think not playing for one of the big clubs, definitely back in the 90s, definitely had an impact on whether a manager picked you or not. I think you were looked upon a little bit unfavourably because they perhaps felt that, I don't know, maybe you weren't good enough to play for one of the big clubs, or you know, you've turned down a big club. What does that say about your mental attitude? I always found it quite odd, to be honest, that I was scoring a lot of goals in a team that was finishing in the bottom half of the table mostly. And yet wasn't really given the kind of credit it deserved, because I think it should stand out more for a manager watching somebody. If somebody can score that amount of goals in a team that's not that great and in the bottom half of the table, surely that stands him out as a player who actually, if you put him in a good team, will actually be even better. So I didn't quite get why you were kind of looked down upon if you didn't play for one of the big boys. But yeah, I'm very proud of the 8 caps that I got. You know, little kid growing up in Guernsey, just a dream to be a footballer and to play for England, and I did both of those whilst I was at Southampton, so you know, I'm still very proud of that to this day. Yeah.
Do you think that's changed at all in terms of getting picked from international teams on reputation or form, like Danny Drinkwater getting picked, Jack Wilshere getting picked, so on that?
Yeah, I think there's a bit of it that goes on. There is a snobbery amongst the England hierarchy about which club you play for still a little bit. I think it's not quite so bad today because you kind of haven't got the amount of players to choose from in this day and age that you had 25 years ago. So, you know, when I look back at my career and the players, the English strikers and attacking midfielders that we had in those days, there was a lot more talent around to pick from in those days than we've got now. So it's actually, because of the numbers, I think it's something like between 30 and 35% of all players that start Premier League games are English now, as opposed to probably nearer 80% when I started. So it's a huge difference. And so if you are playing regularly now in the Premier League and performing well, you do tend to get a chance. Yep.
Hi, Matt. I believe Spurs were interested in signing you at one point. How close were you to signing later?
Yeah, very close. Yeah. I mean, I supported Spurs as a boy growing up, so that was kind of, if I was going to leave Southampton, that would have been the biggest temptation for me, and that's the way it proved. I was 21 at the time, and I actually spoke to, they were the only club I really spoke to and agreed terms on a contract with before changing my mind. And as I said before, to this day, I've got no regrets about those decisions that I made, and more than happy to have spent all my career at Southampton.
What are your thoughts on the way Southampton Football Club's currently run as a business? Do you think we can carry on progressing under the current system?
I think the club's been run incredibly well. When you see where we've come from since going into administration, it's been a heck of a ride for 7 or 8 years. So that's been quite, for me as a Saints fan now, that's been fantastic for me to watch us get better every year. We kind of got to sixth place in the Premier League, and you do kind of look at it and think, like, how are we going to get any better? Because with what's above us, I know Leicester had a freak season last season, but you look at the firepower, the spending power that the guys above us have got, and the only way we can try and compete with that is to keep making sure that recruitment is good. Make sure that all the structures are in place at the football club, which if you lose a manager, it doesn't disrupt the club too much. If you lose a couple of star players, your recruitment's good, you can replace them. And they've done that pretty well. This is probably going to be the first season in 7 seasons where we haven't improved on our league position, which is quite something. However, we've got to a cup final this season, which we haven't done in those 7 years. So I think as a progression of a club, the league position getting better each year was great. I think whilst that was happening, there were quite a few fans who were saying, yeah, it's okay getting better each year, but we want to try and win a trophy. And, we were picking teams which kind of were quite weak at times in some of the cup competitions. And that annoyed, I think, a few of the fans. We did it a little bit to a certain extent this season. We were fortunate that we played teams that also did the same thing, and we got past Crystal Palace and Sunderland with slightly weakened teams, but we got to the latter stages of that competition. We played a very strong team, and it's fantastic now for the fans that we can now look forward to going to Wembley a week on Sunday.
Hi Matt, if you were playing today, would you be tempted by a move to China, or if you were going to leave Southampton, would you want to move to the top Premier League or European club?
I wouldn't probably be tempted by China now. I think if there was going to be a move, I think in this day and age, you'd probably, if somebody like a Real Madrid or a Barcelona came in for you, I think that would be a far more tempting move, albeit not financially more tempting than China, but from a purely football point of view, that would be a much better option. I do kind of look at it and not despair, it's not the right word, because it depends what the player's ambitions are. You've got somebody like Oscar, who's a fantastic footballer, still got his best years ahead of him in football, and yet he's chosen to go and take the money in China and kind of disappear really out there in China. You don't really get to hear about it. Globally, it's not massive. I'm not sure it's ever going to be out there. And you think, yes, you're going to be financially sorted the rest of your life, but had you played in Europe, carried on playing in Europe, you probably would have been, unless you're really stupid with your money, you can still earn enough money in Europe and have the exposure to all the world football that you need without having to go and kind of take obscene amounts of money and kind of be forgotten a bit, really.
Do you think it could impact their international career?
There's a chance that international managers would look at that and think, well, do you know what, the standard of football they're playing isn't that great. When they come back into the international side, are they going to be at a level which is going to be able to compete at that? And I think there'll be several international managers that we're looking at and thinking, I'm not sure I can trust that he's playing at a high enough standard every week. So yeah, it's definitely going to have an impact on that, I think. Yep.
Do you think at Southampton at the moment there are any current academy graduates or people that are playing in and around the first team that have the potential to go on and be sort of heights of the London Shore?
I went up the training ground a lot last week, and I watched a lot of the under-18s train. And there was one lad in there who's, I think, probably above everybody else in that group. That's a young lad called Will Smallbone. scored a goal in the FA Youth Cup at Old Trafford a few weeks back, which was pretty good. But just watching him train, you kind of look at him and he looks the part. And I think by all accounts, he's got a good mentality, which is, you know, it's all very well looking good as a footballer and having all the good attributes that can make you into a footballer. But they're all a waste of time if what's between your ears isn't right. As long as you've got the right attitude, then couple that with a good skill set, then you've got a real chance. And I think Young Will has got a very good chance.
Would you think the top four will be coming in this season?
I think it will be Chelsea, Spurs, Man City, and Man United. I wouldn't take that as any guarantee. I said Leicester get relegated, lucky. Yes.
Yeah. So, where do you stand with the way we've Celtic coming to the Premiership and the reasons for it?
It's a tough one because obviously looking at the league this year, Celtic on. I think they get to win it next week. Mm. If they win, then you know it's just crazy how far ahead they are of everybody else. I'm not sure I agree with teams moving countries. To be honest, that's a separate country. I'm not sure it would work. To be honest, and I'm not sure if they're at a level that would actually survive in the Premier League. Mm. To be honest, I think looking at the kind of players that they recruit, I think a lot of them come from the Championship, and I think that's kind of the level that they'd probably be playing at. So I'm not sure it's a fantastic idea. I think Scotland should actually concentrate a little bit more on making sure that the other teams around Celtic can actually improve them and start giving Celtic a bit of a run for their money. I think that would be better for Scottish football than to have their best team come out of the country altogether.
I was just wondering, what inspired you to create 73 management with Francis Pinoli? Was that something which you observed whilst you were playing professional yourself, that players need a lot more guidance than Shaw?
I think it's come from watching football. It's not from when I was playing, but since I've been a pundit and watching transfers take place and seeing young kids move to football clubs where you kind of think, they're not even going to get a game there. Why are they going there? And the reason they go there is because the agent's getting the most money out of it, and he's talking the player into going there. And so I got a little bit frustrated at people like Scott Sinclair, like Jack Rodwell, who were doing very well at their clubs, go to Man City just to fill a quota of homegrown players, basically, is what it was for. Just to stick them in the squad, say, oh, look, there's one of our homegrown players, but he's never going to get a game. And the kid wastes 2 years of his footballing career, which doesn't sound a great deal, but when you're only going to be playing at the top level for maybe, I don't know, 12, 14 years, it is a long time. And so I felt with Franny, we felt that we wanted to put together a management team that could look after young players and advise them on the best thing for their career and not necessarily the best thing for their bank balance. And that's kind of where it all stemmed from.
Speaking
on
that, what do you make of the whole Joseph Pont situation?
Like,
is it led by money or is it
ambition? I can't see it being led by ambition when he's just gone to West Ham. no disrespect to West Ham, I think as a football club at the moment, I think if you asked anybody in the world of football, you know, which club would you rather be playing at, Southampton or West Ham, given the last five or six years, you'd probably say Southampton. So I think Jose had his head turned, I think, by going to a new agent. I think the agent maybe promised him something that the agent wasn't able to deliver, which was a move to Manchester United. And I think Jose backed himself into a corner, and the club called his bluff, and he lost out. And he ended up going to West Ham. I mean, he was thinking that perhaps he was going to get a move to Manchester United or even to an Everton, when the reality was the two choices he had were to West Ham or West Brom. I know West Brom are having a good season, don't get me wrong, but not quite the level of club that he thought he was going to go to. I can understand at his age he probably wanted one last big payday, but Southampton had already rewarded him quite well. and he felt like he wanted to go elsewhere. And that's his perspective, but it just, I don't think he behaved like a captain for the last 6 months, let's put it that way. Yes.
Just to touch on Arsenal, obviously there's been a lot of criticism about the manager.
Yeah.
Do you think when his time's up?
I'd be very careful what Arsenal fans wish for. Mm. I think, because you've only got to look at what happened to Manchester United when Sir Alex went. Now, if that is what the Arsenal fans are prepared to accept in order to then kick on again, as perhaps Manchester United have two or three seasons where they've kind of fallen backwards, no Champions League football. I think they'll probably get Champions League football this season, so they might feel that they're back on the rise again. If that's what Arsenal fans feel like, then so be it. But he's been incredible, really, given the financial constraints when the new stadium was being built. I think he's very stubborn sometimes. I don't think he does himself any favours. But I think if you're a football club that wants to be playing Champions League football season in, season out, then he's not a bad bloke to have at the helm. I think they might dip out this year, and I think if that does happen, then I think he might step down.
Yeah. What's your opinion on the national side, and what must the FA do in your eyes to make sure we have a better chance in competitions like the World Cup and European Championship?
It's very difficult for the FA because the Premier League, I think, are probably the only ones that can help the English national team, and the Premier League have no interest in helping the English national team. You know, they're there for themselves. You know, they just want their brand to be stronger and go more global and earn more money without any interest whatsoever in the national team, because the only way you're going to get a stronger national team is to have more English players playing in the Premier League. And whilst all the money's here and the foreigners are coming in all the time, the foreign managers are coming in all the time, they're going to bring the foreign players in, and that's going to give less and less opportunities for the English player. So I feel a bit sorry for the FA. I'm not sure there's too much they can do, apart from maybe, I don't know, try and tempt Pep Guardiola to take the England manager job, or you know, somebody of that ilk. Apart from that, you've only got, as an England manager, you can only work with what's given to you as in terms of players, and I don't think we're strong enough in terms of any strength and depth to actually go and challenge for a World Cup right at the moment. So I feel a bit sorry for the FA just on that. Yes.
You mentioned about not enough English players. Would you bring in a quota system or something like that to try and increase that? Because the homegrown has got laws with like Fabregas, Cavendish,
homegrown. Yeah. There are laws there which people skirt around, and there's ways around it, which is a shame. But I'm not sure in this day and age you can, with the freedom of movement all around Europe. It's very difficult to impose quotas, and you know, the fans want to see the best players in the league, and if that means that you know the best players are European players, worldwide players, then you know the Premier League are going to welcome them with open arms, because they want to be known as the best league in the world. You've got to have the best players for them. Yep.
What are your thoughts on safe standard? Do you think it's needed?
I do miss, I think, sometimes the atmosphere that the standing up areas created at football grounds. Obviously, there were reasons why it was made all seater, and you know, we should never forget that. Having said that, the safe standing areas where it's the proper amount of people in the proper amount of spaces with the correct equipment in place, I think should have a place, because I think you see a lot of grounds, there's big portions of the stadium that will stand up and watch the game, and the stewards won't do anything about it. You know, it's a tradition, and people still do it whether they've got a seat or not. So I think safe standing, I think, could have a place in modern football. Yeah.
Just following on, obviously the Saints fans, what's your favourite game you've been to as a fan rather than a player?
Well, that's a good question. I think I'd have to say it's probably very recent, and I think it would have to be the second leg at Anfield. I think going to a place like that, you know, we've never really had the greatest of records going to big grounds. You know, I barely remember. I think we had one win at Liverpool in my whole career. I think one at Old Trafford in my whole career. So it's, you know, pretty rare to go to the big ground and get a result. And to do it in the semi-final of a major cup competition, I think it was incredible. And I think my reaction when the goal went in the studio, oh, I'm pleased the cameras weren't rolled in there. I might be a bit embarrassing, but yeah, I think that one for me would have to stand out. Yeah.
What do you feel about the impact of video refereeing?
I think if it's done properly, I think the video refereeing stuff would be very, very useful. I think it's actually used a little bit already in football. I don't know if you saw Monday Night Football, the Man City Bournemouth game. Bournemouth had an equaliser disallowed. And if you watch the film back, if you watch the replays, the referee wasn't looking at the incident. The linesman had the flag. And the only way that goal could have been disallowed was if the fourth official had told the referee there was infringement in the build-up and you have to disallow it. So I believe it's already being used. And if it's to get the right decision, then 100% use it. You have to be very clear as to the guidelines and which you can use it at, because a lot of tackles that take place, a lot of it is opinions. You know, what one referee might give on the field, the fourth official who's watching the video replay back might actually think, not enough contact there for me for a free kick. So when it's a matter of opinion between two different people, that's going to be very difficult. When it's a matter of fact, so when it's an incident that happens right on the edge of the box and you want to look back at the video to make sure that the penalty is in, you can also check. What I think the best bit of technology we can have, and this is where it's going to be the most useful, is when we have video technology, no goal should ever be disallowed for offside. There should never be another goal allowed for a player in an offside position, because that's a matter of fact. You know, you'll be able to see that. Every goal that's scored, the fourth official would be able to view it in the time it takes for the team to kick off, so it's not going to disrupt the game in any way, shape or form, but you will have the correct decision 100% of the time. So no goal, when that video referee system comes in, no goal should ever be allowed that's in an offside position. And that might upset Jose Mourinho at Old Trafford this season. Yeah.
Do you think ticket prices affect atmospheres, which affect players?
Yes, I believe ticket prices do have an effect on the atmosphere. I think there's almost a different demographic of people that can afford to go and watch football matches now. And I'm not sure that's the right thing, to be honest. I think it's the amount of money. Clubs are no longer reliant like they used to be on ticket sales for football matches. Most of the income now is generated through the TV deals. And I think football clubs should really give the fans a break and make it a lot more affordable for the average man in the street, because it is getting to a point where that's a massive percentage of what somebody is going to be earning in a week. Who's got a family, you know, if he's going to take two kids along, it's a heck of a lot of money. And I think with everything that goes on around football and the money that's coming to it, I think football clubs should take a look at the pricing structure and actually go, do you know what? These are our customers. These are the paying people, the fans who come and watch us, who support us through thick and thin. We need to give them a break, because it doesn't make a massive difference, I don't think, to a football club to charge £45-£50 for a ticket. You're only going to charge those £25 for a ticket. It's not going to make that much of a difference to the budget, given the millions that's coming in through the TV deal. So I think the club should do something about it.
Yeah. Natural coaching, you know, how did that whole startup, ideology, philosophy, any thoughts on that?
My natural coaching?
Yeah.
So it started off because I wanted to give kids an opportunity to develop as a footballer in a way that perhaps they couldn't do if they were associated with a football club at a young age. Because I think a lot of time at these football clubs, it's very structured. I didn't have any professional coaching really until I was about 15 years of age. That's quite unusual in this day and age. A lot of kids now are looked at 7-8 years of age, and the training of the clubs. I feel I actually benefited from not having any professional coaching until I was 15. I was allowed to just do my own thing. I was allowed to experiment. And I think that kind of showed in the way that I played football, where I was a little bit different from most people, and I thought differently. I wanted kids to be able to just let their natural ability come out and not be afraid to make mistakes by experimenting.
Do you feel like it's become too systematic in the clubs now?
It is a little bit systematic. I watch a lot of football, as you know. I've started watching it a lot more under 18, a lot more under 23 football. And what I see there is quite bland, if I'm honest. It's football by numbers. And it's not really conducive to producing players who are going to be ready to go and play in your first team. So that's why I kind of started up the whole natural coaching thing. I wanted just to give kids a chance to come along. They're not really shouted at. If they make a mistake, they're never criticised. I want people to be able to learn by making mistakes and not be afraid to do that. And I think that sometimes at football clubs, kids go in and are too safety conscious. So they don't want to be seen to be making a mistake because the coach will jump on them. And you know that might affect whether they be taken on for the next year. I just wanted to give kids an environment where they could just come and in a stress-free environment and be the best footballer they possibly can.
Two questions. One, which team do you think will get relegated this season? And two, do you think Premier League clubs should do more to help disabled fans?
Okay, the second one is a no-brainer. I think there's challenges in place that some clubs have taken a long time to put right. So I think I'm not criticising all the clubs, because a lot of them do a lot for their disabled fans. I think some have been a little bit slow on the uptake, if I'm honest. So that needs to get better. In terms of the relegation, it's a tough one at the moment because you know you're seeing teams getting results where you just didn't think it was possible. I mean, 6 weeks ago you would have said Hull were certainties to go down. They brought a new manager in who's doing fantastically well for them. Swansea the same. Couldn't see them getting out of it. I'd still probably say Sunderland will go down. I've got a funny feeling that Crystal Palace might join them. And the third team, I think it might be Leicester. I really do. I've been watching them for weeks and thinking they can't keep being this bad. They can't keep being this bad. And every week, they're that bad. And you just think at this point in time, that where's the next win going to come from? That's a real struggle. Next win, next goal. I mean, only they scored a league goal this year. That's a major concern. Yeah,
and I'm curious, as a Sky Sports pundit, I'm curious to know how often you hear about young and up and coming players that are compared to players such as Lionel Messi, perhaps prematurely. And how do you feel about it?
Yeah, no, not that often. I mean, we're kind of dealing with the top end of the stuff most of the time. As I said, I've started watching a few more under 23 games since we set up 73 management club. Most of the time, you kind of hear the occasional whisper about a player who's coming through a club which perhaps we've got good contacts at, but it's not on a daily basis or anything like that. Yeah.
Just going back to the Leicester, do you think that they won't improve without getting rid of Ranieri? Do you think he needs to go for them to find some sort of change? Because that's been a lot of the speculation at the moment.
It has been a lot of speculation, and I think football would be in a very bad place if Claudio was to lose his job. What they did last season was incredible, and you know, for him to lose his job this season, I don't think. Sometimes football people always look at the manager when things aren't going right. Now last season, those players got a hell of a lot of praise for what they did, and yet when it starts going wrong, everyone looks at the manager. Hang on a minute, let's have a look at the players. They've all been given their nice new contracts, their nice big cars, and you think, are they really as hungry as they were last year? Are they really trying as hard as they were last year? And I'm not saying they're not trying, but they ain't trying anywhere near as hard as they did last year. And so for the manager to take the flak for that would be, for me, completely out of order, and I'd be very surprised if Ranieri was sacked before the end of the season.
Got time for a couple more questions.
Yep.
As you spoke about being loyal, so glad. What's your opinion on the Alexis Sanchez contract situation?
I'm not sure that they'd have too much loyalty to Arsenal Football Club. I think they're obviously top draw players. They're not really anywhere near winning a title. If that's what they want out of their careers, it all depends on the player's ambition. If he wants to go and win as many medals as he can before the end of his career, then he'll probably leave Arsenal because they're just not at that level at the moment. They're playing at a great level, obviously with Champions League football and everything, but I'd be very surprised if they were to win the Champions League. I'd be even more surprised to be on the Premier League. So, yes, it would be great if Arsenal could keep hold of them, but I really couldn't criticise them if they thought, do you know what, I've done my time here and I want a different challenge. I think there's anything wrong with that.
Last one.
Do you believe that clubs should possibly have, so there should be a parent club and maybe a second club so that they feed the players through the second club into the higher club, if you like, so the way Chelsea are maybe loaning their players out to one team specifically and they're all still playing together?
It's very difficult to do that, I think, in this country. I think you've got such a tradition of 92, well, more than 92, because there's a lot of teams in the conference who have played league football as well. So much tradition, so much heritage for it to change. You know, a lot of these teams are the focal point of their community, and for them to be taken over by one of the big boys, I think would kind of take something away from that club.
But financially, if they were stable, would you reckon that would be better for them because they'd be able to maybe play in a better league? Or?
No, I'm not sure that's the. I think if you're talking about financial stability, I think football clubs have a responsibility to live within their means, and I think in this day and age, I think more and more clubs are doing that. You know, there were a lot of clubs in the past who have kind of gambled and spent too much money they didn't have, and went to the wall. I think in this day and age, there's more responsibility at the football clubs, and I think they're run a whole lot better than they used to be. So I've never been a huge fan of clubs having, the loan system is there for those players to go out and get experience at lower league levels. I don't think they have to have a specific club that they should loan their players to. I think it's good for them to have a broad spectrum and be able to loan their clubs to all types of different clubs to help them out as well. The football pyramid in England is pretty unique in the world in terms of the top four divisions that we have. I don't think you get that strength and depth in any other country in the world. And I think that would be a shame to lose it and lose the identity of some of our football clubs.
Having had the pleasure of inviting Matt into the university on a number of occasions before, I have to say, I think that's probably the toughest grilling you've ever had in regards to such a range and a breadth of questions. So thank you to all of you who asked questions, because there were some really, really good ones there. But as always, it's a delight to welcome Matt into the university. He always speaks very openly and very candidly, has a very expansive knowledge, of course, across the game as a player, as a pundit, but also in terms of his broader base of knowledge in respect to all things that relate to football. So please put your hands together and thank...